Well, good afternoon. I'm Vyacheslav Rusakiy, and I'll present you today. I'll talk you today about nano-optoelectronics and nanophotonics. Of course, this will be only a very short introduction to these two subjects because the fields of nano-optoelectronics and nanophotonics is very big. It's tremendous. It's like an iceberg, so that even in a 20 hours, 30 or 60 hours course, we would be able to cover only the upper part of this iceberg, and in a talk of 1 hour, of course, we will cover only the very top of this iceberg, and the underwater part will remain for you for study, for individual study. Of course, on the basis of nano-optoelectronics and nanophotonics is nanoscience and nanotechnology, because you should know about the principle, about the structure, that is about the science of the object, and you should have technology, in this case nanotechnology, for preparing such objects. And if one refer to a broad definition of nanoscience and nanotechnology, they are about the exploiting phenomena for materials having 1, 2, or 3 dimensions reduced to the nanoscale. You can see that a lot of books, a lot of monographs are edited on this subject, on the subject of nanotechnology and nanoptoelectronics. At the end of this talk, I will give a short list of references of monographs, and also some review papers for you to study further. And what means nanoscale? Nanoscale is around the mesoscale of the things. If one refers to the entire scale of length, there is a micro level. It means the structure of atoms, the level of atoms. There is a mesoscale at around the nanometers, and a largest further scale which is characteristic for bulk materials. And of course, in the if one increase this scale further, we'll go to cosmology. So, nanometer scale is called mesoscale. It means around from 1 nanometers to around 100 nanometers. And you know that there are basically four types of interaction: the electromagnetic interaction, the strong interaction, the weak interaction, and gravitational interaction. Strong and weak interaction refer to the to atomic interaction. It refers to the elementary particles. The gravitational interaction refers to cosmology, that is to the large scale. And our field of nano-optoelectronics, actually the field of optoelectronics and photonics, refer only to electromagnetic interaction, so that all the phenomena which will be discussed are based on electromagnetic interaction. The gravitational interaction is for cosmology. It means that at the level of planets, solar system, because you know that the star is orbited by planets, all the star together can form a galaxy like our Milky Way, and the size of Milky Way is very big. It's like a plate with a thickness of 1,000 light years and the diameters of around 100,000 light years. So that actually it is a quasi two-dimensional system. Further, galaxy can form a cluster of galaxy, actually Milky Way enter in the local group together with the Andromeda and the Triangle galaxy and around 100 of smaller dwarf galaxy. And the distance between the our Milky Way and the Andromeda is around 1 million light years. So you can imagine what is the scale there. But now we will refer to mesoscale, that is the nanometer scale. And nanoscience refers to research area devoted to study of various phenomena at these small size devices. And it is, of course, a cross-disciplinary because it includes also physics, chemistry, and biology. The heart of nanoscience, as I told, is mesoscopic physics. And actually, the word of nano was noticed as early as the fourth century of around fourth century by a Roman glassmaker, which worked with making colored glass, and they found that by changing the mixture of metallic particles in these glasses, one can change the color of the glass, and this actually as a result of physics at the nanoscale. Of course, they didn't know then that they deal with the physics at the nano level. But anyway, they observed this. In 1883, films containing silver halides for photography were invented by the founder of Kodak. In 1908, Gustav May first proposed the explanation of the size dependence of color, that is the photonics. And it is well known the expression of Feynman in 1959 that there is a plenty of room at the bottom. It means that the field of nano-old actually is very large. And actually, the exploration of this nano field started at the 1560 years, particularly in 1957. Ralph Landauer realized the importance of quantum mechanics physics in device at this nanoscale. And at the end of the 20th century, actually the mesoscopic physics was ongoing. There were already quantum dots, quantum wire, and quantum wells. This is the distribution of objects at the nanoscale. The upper row referred to natural objects, biological objects, and the lower row referred to man-made structures. So at the 0.1 nanometer, that is at an angstrom level, at an angstrom level, there is a level of atoms. We have just artificial atoms. At the level of 1 nanometer to 100 nanometer, this is the range of nanoscience and nanotechnology from 1 nanometer. And here we see here the structure of the DNA molecule. And at the artificial man-made structure, there is a quantum dot consisting of a lot of atoms. You can see each atom is seen here in a transition electron microscope image, carbon nanotubes, and a device based on such a nanotubes. Further, in the micrometers range, we have biological objects, single molecular, and further more complex biological objects and insects at the level of 1 millimeter, 1 nanometer. In the man-made structure, we have integrated circuit, a big integrated circuit, and a device at the scale of 1 centimeter and more. The field of nanophotonics and nano-optoelectronics relate, as I told, to different such as nanomaterials, nanoprocessing and characterization, and nanoproducts. And nanoscience and technology is at the core of all of these fields. That means that on the basis of nanoscience and nanotechnology, nanomaterials are developed, they should be characterized to see their properties, and further on the basis of technological process to produce nanoproducts, that is the products of nano optoelectronics and nanophotonics. And also there are different fields which overlap each other. The nanoelectronics, you see nanoelectronics, nanophotonics and nanomechanics. On the intersection of nanoelectronics and nanophotonics, and nano-optoelectronics is a field of nanoelectronics. At the intersection of nanophotonics and nanomechanics, there are nano-optomechanics. And at the intersection of nano-optoelectronics and nanomechanics, there are nano-electromechanics. And you see here devices which are each of them are respectively developed on the basis of taking into account the nanoelectronic properties and nanomechanical properties, for instance, for nano-optoelectronics devices. Also, the nanotechnology came from different field of science, from solid-state physics, from chemistry, and from biology. You see that organic chemistry and quantum chemistry actually deal with the object at the sub-nanometer level, because it deal with molecules which are formed by atoms, that is at the angstrom level. But with increasing the complexity of chemical objects, we go to the nanoscale, that is to nanotechnology. Vice versa, there. Solid-state physics deal with big objects, with bulk materials, but by fine structuring of bulk objects, we go to decreasing the scale and go again to the nanotechnology. And biotechnology also at last cover this field of nanotechnology. So nanotechnology is the field which cover all the discipline, physics, biology, and chemistry. And nanotechnology is actually everywhere, you can see here. It is in the development of solar cell, and the development of materials, data storage, electronics, also in object dealing with the biological, in medicine, and catalysis, household, and cosmetics. What is nanotechnology? As I told, nanotechnology deal with scale under 100 nanometers. And there are two basic technologies for preparing such nano-objects. First one is the top-down, which is characteristic for physics, as I shown in the previous slide. Going from bulk materials to nanostructure materials by means of lithographical methods, and this is in relation with the Moore laws, which I'll discuss a little bit later. It is related to lithographic patterning. And another is bottom up, which is characteristic for chemistry. That is, we start with atom, assembling atom in very simple clusters, and then the cluster are more complex, and we go again to nanoscale. And again, we refer here to the famous expression of Feynman, that there is plenty of room at the bottom. So here, this slide illustrates these two approaches. The top-down approach, which is based on lithography, and the bottom-up approach, which is based on assembling nano-objects from atoms. From atoms, then molecular, and at last the nano-objects. And there are different approach for the design strategy of first approach is atomic manipulation, Another approach is self-assembly of atoms and lithography. That is, these two refer to bottom-up, and this is referred to top-down approach, and all of them are actually directed to preparing functional nanosystems. So, bottom-up. Bottom-up design is actually very time-consuming. One can calculate that in order to assemble object at the level of 1 centimeter, at the scale of 1 centimeter, with 1 nanometer nanostructures, at the speed of assembling 1,000 atoms, for instance, in 1 second, one sees that to cover 1 centimeter, we need 3,000 years. Even more time we will need at the three-dimensional level. In order to cover 1 cubic centimeter, in such a way, we will need 32,000 million years. So that it's very, very complex subject to assemble very large objects at the level of 1 centimeter by the bottom-up approach. It's easy. It's easy to in this case to go from to top down, and the top down is actually based on lithography, and there are different types of lithography. First, more usually, you know, is the optical lithography. But optical lithography is very limited to the resolution, because the resolution is determined by the wavelength of the light, and wavelength of the light is around 300 nanometers, so that the resolution of optical lithography is very limited. X-ray lithography increases because the quantum energy of X-ray is bigger, respectively the wavelength is lower, so that the resolution of X-ray lithography is better. Further we go to beam method of lithography, electron beam lithography and ion beam lithography. And at the during the last 1-2 decades, I explored the nanoimprint lithography and the scanning probe method lithography, such as deep pan, local oxidation, and so on. And you can see the instrumentation. The instrumentation for nanoscience is actually very complex. There are also methods simple for preparing nano objects. For instance, electrochemical depositions or chemical bus deposition is not so complex. But in order to have a well-controlled assembly of atoms in at a nanoscale, one needs very complex technological method. For instance, molecular beam lithography. You see the which is the complexity of a system for molecular beam lithography, electron beam lithography. Also, you see here is a very complex. And for characterization, again, one should have a transmission electron microscopy, which is very expensive. One transmission electron microscope costs around $1 million, not less than $1 million. And in order to prepare samples, one need to have ion beam tools for preparing samples, which again cost $1 million. So that you can imagine what is the cost. And for characterization, also scanning transmission microscopy, for instance, can be used. And this is a resolution of microscopy techniques. As I told, the human eyes see at the level of one millimeters. The optical lithography, the field of optical lithography you see here at the level of micron, 0.1 micron is the limit of resolution for optical microscopy. And further, we need transmission electron microscopy to go further to atomic level resolution. Also, scanning probe. There are a wide diversity of scanning probe method, which also can ensure a resolution of the at the nanometer and even sub-nanometer level. And the nanotechnology is closely related to the Moore's law. Actually, the Moore's law lie on the basis of all micro and microelectronics and micro optoelectronics, and it told that a 30% decrease in the size of printed dimension should occur every two years. And this is based on the increasing the resolution of a lithographical method. You can see here how it occurs with time for 17th to our 20th years. At the beginning of this century, we see that the resolution were about 100 nanometers. And now, in the 10th year, we reach the node of 22 nanometers. We are now go further to the 10 nanometers scale. But actually, at the industrial level, this 10 nanometer scale is not still reached. So the actual node is 22 nanometers. And you see here that even in 2004, CMOS technology already ensured the integration of 150 million transistors in one chip, and the resolution was at the 90 nanometer design rule. The frequency reached the 3 gigahertz frequency. And the density of transistor, you see here, is 10 to 9 degree transistor at 1 square centimeters. And as I told you, the resolution is 22 nanometers. And you see here again in relation to the Moore laws how the density of transistor increases with time in the scale from 17th of previous century to now. Actually, every 18-24 months there was a doubling number of transistors in one chip. Actually, now I should say that the curve is not going so sharp further. There is already a saturation, so that Moore laws actually will not work further, and we will need other principle of in order to go further with the development of devices, with increasing the density of devices. We should explore other fields, and nanoscience and nanotechnology is one of these. Is one of these fields which should be explored to go further in the integration and actually to introduce new principle of device working. So actually most of devices which are explored now, which are prepared now, are based on silicon. You know that silicon is the basic material in integrated circuits. There are last time during the 10 maybe 20 years started to be explored other materials such as gallium nitride, for instance, zinc oxide, silicon carbide and gallium nitride are explored very intensely for high frequency and power electronics. But anyway, more than 90% of devices are on silicon. But even on silicon, if one make silicon porous, that is if one characterizes the dimension of silicon, if I reduce to nanometers, again we can widen the field of implementing of the silicon. You can see the bulk silicon is work at the level photon energy of 1,000 nanometers, but if we do the silicon porous, we go in the visible range at the level of 600 nanometers, that is in the visible range, and if go to polymeric silicon, we can go even to ultraviolet region, that is to in the region of 300-400 nanometers. And you see some devices prepared on the on porous silicon, that is a structure with several layers of silicon with different porosity, high porosity, low porosity, and an active layer is prepared in between these layers, silicon layers with different porosity. Again, one can make cylindrical circular structure and to prepare microcavity design for photonic applications, and also you can see here planocentric microcavity to develop again optoelectronic photonic devices. And the development of nanoelectronics again in the time scale, you see here at in 19th there was the first transistor was elaborated, and the first integrated circuit. Further, in the 18 years, we have here quantum the quantum Hall effects was explored, and Aronoff-Bohr rings type structures. Further, quantum dots in the 19th, quantum dots start to be very intensively explored, and even manipulation of atoms, and you can see a quantum coral structure composed of atoms. It is a man-made artificial structure. And now, in 20s, we intensively explored devices based on single molecular transistor, carbon nanoscale transistor, carbon nanotube transistor, and other type of devices. So the main ingredient of an electronics are at the in one dimension, at two dimensional structure. At two dimensions, there is a two dimensional electron gas. At one dimensional structure, there are quantum wires, and at zero-dimensional structure, we have quantum dots. Respectively, nanomaterials and devices which are based on this type of structure, there are nanoelectromechanic system, carbon nanotubes, graphene, device using superconductivity, it means that using the spin, electron spin effects, which are supposed to constitute the basis for the quantum computing, that is for increasing the power of computers. And in order to go further to understand it, what is on the basis of nano-optoelectronics and nanophotonics, one should refer to similarities between the electrons, and photons, because at the basis of optoelectronics, nano-optoelectronics are electrons, and on the basis of nanophotonics are photons. So the interaction of electrons with the electronic system with the photonic system, actually, each of them, that electrons and photons, are characterized by the momentum and by the energy. And moving charge is creating electric fields, and vice versa, electric fields make charge moving, and creation of and the photons are generated by creation of light, and respectively, another part is detection of the generated photons. But anyway, they interact with each other. And you can this slide illustrates the similarities between the photons and electrons. The propagation of electrons is characterized by the wavelengths, and the wavelengths depends on the effective mass and on the frequency. H is the Planck constant. Similarly, the propagation of photons, that is the light wavelength, is determined again by the impulse, and it is characterized by speed of light, and again by the frequency. And description of electrons in a bulk body, for instance, is described by the Schrödinger equation, and the photon are described by Maxwell equation, and both of the solution of both this type of equation leads to determination of eigenvalues if either for electrons or eigenvalues eigenwaves for photons, and respectively the eigenenergy, that is the energy level for electrons, and respectively the energy level of lights, which is actually the frequency of lights. And the free space solution, you can see the similarity between the electrons and photon. Free space solution.
For electrons, the free space solution is a plane electron wave, and for photons, it is a plane photon wave. It's the the propagation of electrons are affected by Coulomb potential, and respectively the electron wave function decay exponentially in the forbidden depth. For photons, again, the photon tunneling through the classical forbidden zone are determined by the electron in the magnetic fields, and the decay is exponentially inside this forbidden zone for photons. Respectively, the dimensionality. You can see the one dimensionality of electrons, electronics, is the structure and dimensionality of photonic structure, exactly, which without actually any nanoscale confinement. And thin quantum, the two dimensions refer to thin quantum world, which refers to one-dimensional confinement. For photonics, this is the confinement is related to the plane waveguide. That is one-dimensional confinement. In electronic system, we have quantum wires, that is two-dimensional confinement. And photonic system, we have optical fibers, again. Finally, quantum dots, zero-dimensional structure, that is three-dimensional confinement, and microsphere or microcavity, which represent the three-dimensional confinement of photons. Again, there is a similarity in the dispersion cup. You see here the dispersion relation for photons and dispersion relation for electrons. Again, both of them are characterized by the impulse and especially by the wave vector from photons and wave vector respectively for electrons and for photons. And this dispersion relation leads actually to the formation of the pendulum, which is a very exciting feature of both electronic and photonic system. You can see here the formation of band gap in the bulk material, that is not all the energy range is forbidden for moving electrons. There is a band gap in between the conduction band and the valence band. Also in photonic system, one can see the formation of band gap. The electronic crystal is actually determined by the potential distribution. Potential distribution in the space. The photonic crystals are determined by the distribution in the space of the dielectric constant. That is periodic distribution of the dielectric constant or the refractive index, because the refractive index is actually the square root from the dielectric function. And you see here the calculation of the band structure, which results in band gap for different semiconductors. Here is for bulk semiconductors, for carbon, for silicon, germanium, gallium arsenide, arsenic, zirconium. And in each of them, you can see that there is a forbidden gap in between the maximum of the valence band and the minimum of the conduction band. And there are two types of, semiconductors. One type is gyro band gap, another type is the indirect band gap. In most of cases, the minimum and the maximum conduction volume management. If at the gram is the center of the volume point, that is in the gamma point. But in some crystals, silicon, for example, the maximum of the valence band is the gamma point, while the minimum of the conduction band is at the point.
Here we have the indirect band gap materials. Similarly,
we have different dimensionality in electron system. You can see here different dimensionality in photonic system. And here are in natural objects, and here are several types of man-made photonic systems. The one dimension photonic system is actually there, constituted by different layers of materials with different reflective index. If the material is constructed from cylinders, we have a two-dimensional photonic system. And if it is constructed of small tubes, periodically distributed in space, that is each of these two types of tubes is of material with different reflective index, respectively, what we have three-dimensional photonic system. And the photonic bandgap for in the case of one-dimensional photonic system. Here is the dispersion path of photons in the free space, in the free space. You see here that there is a linear dependence of the energy and the wave number, the wave vector, and the slope of this linear dependence is determined by the speed of light. In the material, the speed of light, you know, is decreased, it depends on the refractive index. The larger, the higher is the refractive index, the slower is the light in the material. And especially the slope of this curve decreases with increasing the reflective index. But assembling two-dimensional photonic crystal leads to the formation of band gaps similar to the formation of band gaps in electronic crystal. And you see here a photonic band gap for a period with alternating layers with different reflective index. That was for one-dimensional system. Here is a more complex subphotonic structure. It is for two-dimensional photonic. It's the better for the steel system constituted from cylinders arranged in a periodic structure.
And also, one can refer to a 2.5 dimensional crystal. We have actually a structure composed of cylinders, but a very thin layer. That it is called a 2.5 dimension. And finally, a 3-dimensional system, which is composed in all three directions. We have a periodic distribution of the electric function, that is the index of refraction. Here is the so-called Yablonovitae materials, which is prepared by drilling holes in respective direction on the different angle at the surface of the material. And you see here a cubic structure. And respectively of the forbidden gaps for Yablonovitae and for such type of photonic dimension photonic crystal, again we have here a photonic bandgap. But photonic bandgap depends not only on the arrangement and on the dimension, because of course they depend on the dimension and on the arrangement, similarly to the crystal structure. For different crystal structure we have this different energetic structure. It depends on the distribution of atoms in the elementary cell. You know that there are cubic cell, cubic centered cell, cubic face centered cells, virgin structure which are hexagonal, and so on. You know, different syngonia. Similarly, in photonic crystal, depend on the structure,
how these cubes or these cylinders are arranged, but also depends on the material. You can see here the tandems for material with identical arrangement of structure, but composed of different materials from polyamide A, from silicon, and for silicon nitride. You can see here that the band gap, the photonic structure, and respectively the band gap is different. Here the band gap is narrower for the polyamide, while it is larger for silicon, for a photonic crystal made from silicon with the same arrangement of structure. Opaline structures, there are two types of opaline structure, which are made of microspheres, and inverse.
Which are made of void instead of
compact sphere. We have here a void, and respectively, it is called direct opaline and inverse opaline structures. You can see how it looks in the image, in the transmission electron image, in the scanning electron image. Respectively, the calculation of the band gap, you see the calculation of the band gap structure for direct opal and for inverse opal, made from different spheres or for different voids. And you see here that the band gap for a direct opal here is this, narrower than the photonic band gap for a photonic crystal with inverse opal structure. You can see here is 1.5, and here is twice, 3.2. Respectively, what we photonic crystals are widely used for producing directional propagation of light. You see here the directionality depending on the band gap structure of an opaline structure. If one refers to frequencies below the band gap, because here is the band gap. Below the band gap, you see here that is the directionality is very poor. That is actually it propagates in all the directions. The light propagate in all the directions through such a photonic structure, opaline structure. In the band gap, you can see here that there is already a well defined directionality, and upper at frequency a little bit higher than the band gap, you see that very good directionality. That is by making different photonic structure, different opaline structures, different arrangement of refractive index, one can use they for obtaining the well direction emission of light from different objects. At the larger scale, this can be used for the development of different photonic applications. For instance, photonic crystals are widely used for enhancing nonlinearity, for filtering, for better dispersive elements, and for guiding light, for better guiding light in different structures, and for so-called negative refractive index materials, that is metamaterials, because you know that the index of refraction of materials is always larger than unity. Unity is only for the free space, that is for the vacuum. For any materials, the index of refraction is bigger than one. But photonic crystal structures, that is metamaterials, by arranging different photonic crystal structures, one can reach refractive index is lower than unity or even negative refractive index. Of course, not in all the frequency range, but at some specific frequency, one can achieve zero photo or even zero value or even negative refractive index. And such type of materials can be used for the construction of different lenses with super resolution, because as I told, the resolution is determined by the wavelengths of light. In such a structure, they will be not anymore determined by the wavelengths of light, so one can reach super resolution independent of the wavelengths of the light. And finally, one can make a whole optical processor based on photonic crystal application. That is integration of a generator, integration of a waveguide, integration of dispersive elements, respectively the diffraction lattice, and finally a detector integrated in one circuit. That is all photonic processor. So now we'll go further to quantum confinement. What means quantum confinement? It means that the energy level of a system depends on the dimensionality. You see here for a quantum well, that is a two-dimensional electron systems like two electron gas. The density of states, it's a step function. In the bulk, there is a continuous dependent of the density of state of energy, that is, it's a square, that the density of state is square root from the energy. In this case, in the case of one-dimensional confinement, we have here a step function. In quantum wire, the energy level are quantized, there is no anymore a continuous distribution of levels through the energy, and respectively the density of states is again a step function with the exponential decay. And finally, in the case of three-dimensional confinement, that is in zero-dimensional structures such as quantum dots, there is a quantized levels of energy, and respectively the density of state represents a delta function, which is in the ideal case there is a very narrow line. Respectively, quantum confinement in a quantum world. What means quantum world? We have two types of material: a material with a narrow band gap and a material with a wider band gap. The narrow materials with a narrow band gap constitute the well, and the materials with wider band gap if the dimension of these two structures are reduced to nanometer level, then we have a confinement. It means that the energy are not anymore continuous, but the energy level are discrete. Respectively, and this depends on the quantum well and also on the barrier, on the material which constitutes the barrier. In the quantum dot, again, you can see the distribution of energy in a bulk material. In an atom, we have discrete energy levels. When atoms are put together in a bulk material, they lead to a band structure. There is continuous distribution of levels in the conduction band. There is a continuous distribution of level in the valence band, and there is a forbidden gap. And this forbidden gap depends on the type of materials. Respectively, we have dielectric materials when the band gap is larger than 4-5 electron volts, and we have semiconductor materials when the band gap is at the level of 3 electron volt, 2 electron volt, and lower. Respectively, if one go again to quantum dots, the level again, like in atoms, start to be quantized. That is, again, we have a a discrete distribution of energy level. Respectively, you see here the energy level and the conduction band and the valence band, respectively, the transition between the lowest energy in the conduction band and the upper level and the valence band is bigger. That is actually the band gap of material increase with decreasing the dimension of the structure. Decreasing the dimension of the quantum dots, the band gap actually decreases because the distance between the lowest and the highest level increases. There are different scales of physics which determine where the quantization start to play a role. And this scales are, and the classical length is the mean electron path, free path. That is the distance between two scattering of electrons. Electron can be scattered by collision of one electron with another electron, or by collision of an electron with impurity atoms. Impurity can be neutral or can be ionized. Also, can be scattered by phonons. And this determines the mean free path of electron. This is a classical length. A quantum length is determined by the de Broglie wavelength, that is the electron have the energy of, it depends on the energy of electron having the Fermi energy. And you see here the formula for the de Broglie wavelength. Another scale is exciton Bohr radius. Exciton Bohr radius, it depends on the reduced mass, and reduced mass is determined by the mass of electron, and because exciton is actually a quasi particle consisting of one electron and one hole. So the exciton Bohr radius depends on the reduced mass and also by the dielectric constant of the medium. And here is the Bohr radius for AB is the Bohr radius for the hydrogen atom. So that when it starts quantization to play role. In the conventional device, you see here the scattering, the mean free path is determined by scattering, and the scale, the dimension is larger, much larger than the mean free path. If the dimension is lower than the mean free path, we have then ballistic transport, ballistic electron transport. If the dimension of the structure is bigger than the de Broglie wavelengths, we have no quantization. That is, quantization starts in electronic system, quantization starts when the dimension is lower than the de Broglie wavelengths. Respectively, another length scale which determines the single electron charging and respectively the working of single electron transistor is determined by the specific capacitance, the Boltzmann constant, and this size determines the operation of a single electron transistor. The Bohr radius determine the electronic structure and respectively the optical properties of materials, because optical properties depend on the band gap of the material. So the de Broglie wavelength determine the transport properties, the capacitance respectively determines the single electron properties, and optical properties are determined by the relation between the dimension of a quantum system and the exciton Bohr radius. This more simple quantum structure, the one-dimensional quantum structure, is the two-dimensional electron gas. And the two-dimensional electron gas is formed at the hetero junction at the interface of materials with different bandgaps. You can see that there is a very narrow region where the electrons are confined, and respectively there is a two-dimensional electron gas is formed. And it is the dimension of this layer, the thickness of this layer is less than 10 nanometers. then we have a quantum system. And basically on this two-dimensional electron gas, three Nobel Prizes were awarded due to the devices elaborated, invented on the basis of two-dimensional electron gas. That is in the case of two-dimensional quantum structure, that is one-dimensional quantization. Further, the quantum Hall effect. You know what means Hall effect. Hall effect means that if you have a semiconductor, we put this semiconductor in a magnetic field directly perpendicular to the surface of the semiconductor. We pass the current in one direction, then in perpendicular direction, perpendicular to the magnetic fields and perpendicular to the direction of current. In the lateral direction, the electron and hole are separated, and a new field appears. This field is called the Hall field. And in the classical, that is in the bulk materials, the resistance in the both in the longitudinal direction and in the Hall direction, that is in the direction perpendicular to both the magnetic field and the direction of color of current, there is a linear dependence. That is a linear dependence between the resistor and the magnetic field. In the case of quantization, that is when the dimension of the particularly the dimension of the two dimensional at the nanometer level, you can see anymore a linear dependence of the resistivity, resistivity is changed in steps, and that is it is quantized, and there is a new units for the resistance, which depends on the Planck constant and the charge of the electron. Two fundamental units. Charge of electrons and the whole plan determine these quantization units of resistance. Next structure, if the first structure was two dimensional system electron gas, respectively one dimensional quantization. Now we'll go to two dimensional quantization, that is to the quantum wire. And there are different technologies for preparing quantum wire. A simple method is the chemical vapor deposition, which is initialized by some metallic quantum dots. And in a liquid solids process, in a chemical vapor deposition liquid solid process, nanowire start to grow on the metallic. On the metallic quantum dots and grow perpendicularly to the surface of the substrate. One can use other methods, for instance, electrochemical deposition again to prepare nanowires, chemical bus deposition. But another method is the so-called template method. One can use a template which consists of a porous template with pore directly perpendicular to the surface. Actually, now a wide range of alumina, for instance, or alumina porous templates are available. And by deposition of different materials in pores of these alumina templates, one can prepare quantum wires if the dimension of pore are less than 100 nanometers. For instance, at the level of 10 nanometers deposition, and one can deposit the metals. One can deposit semiconductors, also magnetic materials, and so on. But this method, chemical vapor deposition, the plated method, are not very well in order to have a better distribution of quantum wire.
usually a so-called method for on the basis of the grooves is employed. That is, for instance, here we have a substrate of gallium arsenide. We prepare a groove on the substrate, and further we grow different quantum well structures. That is layers with very thin layers on these grooves, and in such a case, a perpendicular nanowire consisting of gallium rich nanowire is formed, and on wells of these structures, in between different quantum wells, nanowires are also formed here. And you see here a transmission electron image where in such a groove a quantum wire is well resolved here. And respectively, since we have quantum wires, we have quantization. Respectively, here we see optical properties that photoluminescence, also the transition will have a similar shape. That is, we have peaks which are determined by the transition between different level and the quantized level and the valence band to quantized levels in the conductance bands. Respectively, on the basis of such type of quantum wires, a lead structure can be prepared. Here is illustrated a light emitting structure based on such type of nanowires prepared by the technology of V-groove or V-groove structures. Again, such kind of structure can be used for not only for light emitted dyes, but also by lasers. You can see here the dependence of the emission power depending on the function of the pumping energy, of the pumping power, and you can see here a threshold at which the laser start to work. And respectively, here we have the model structure, because for a light emitting structure, there will be a sharp distribution of the energy of the quantum energy. It means the light will constitute a very broad wavelength range. Here we have a narrow distribution, which is determined by the model structure of the cavity. Another employment of quantum wires are field effect transistor. You see here a field effect transistor based on a nanowire. We have drain, we have source, and we have gate. Here is the gate, and by applying the potential to the gate, one can determine the current flow through the quantum wire. That is, we have a field effect transistor, and this type of field effect transistor work in the terahertz region. You know that actually there is a very big challenge to elaborate devices which are working in the terahertz region. The devices working on bulk materials are working only up to the gigahertz region. You can see here by using field effect transistor, one go further to the terahertz region. And here there are some illustrations of quantum wire. A field effect transistor based on a junction of two types of semiconductor materials. It seems okay. So, MG. The current In such a case, in the case of field effect resistor made of quantum wire, is determined not by the classical transport, which is determined by the mean free path of electron, but it is we are in the regime of ballistic transport. And here is the image. Here is an image of a quantum wire prepared on a two-dimensional electron gas that is a heterojunction. At the interface of heterostructure, a two-dimensional electron gas is formed, and by lithography, one can etch all the material, leaving only this light line here, in the form of these two narrow line, and as a result, a quantum wire is formed here in this place with a length of 140 nanometer and with a thickness with a diameter of 80 nanometer. And since we are in the nanometer range, less than 100 nanometer, we can see here the effect of quantization, that is the transport through this quantum field effect transistor is not a linear dependence. You can see that we have here a step function, which is determined by that h, that is Planck constant, divided by two electron charge. This is the unit of the resistance, respectively, and it of course depends on temperature. Quantization in such a case can be realized only at lab temperature. That you can see here at 20 Kelvin. At 20 Kelvin, there is some tendency to this step function, but it is not well resolved. But if you go further to temperature at the level of 1 Kelvin, this effect, quantum size effect, that is the ballistic transport, is very well resolved. So, the next structure is quantum dots. First of all, one-dimensional structure, two-dimensional electron gas. Further, there was two-dimensional structure, that is quantum wires, and or two-dimensional confinement or one-dimensional structure. And now we go to three-dimensional confinement or zero-dimensional structure. That is zero-dimensional structure. In all three directions are reduced to nanometer size. That is, we have quantum dots. And here is an example of self-assembled quantum dots. There is a well arranged in the space quantum dots prepared on a silicon substrate, and respective quantum dots consisting of silicon. And also similarly can be made a germanium in silicon array if you will use germanium on a silicon substrate. And where the quantum dots I employed? First of all, they are employed very widely in heterostructure. If one refer to the history of heterostructure laser, the first heterostructure was developed on the basis of two electron gas. Further, basic characteristic of a laser is the threshold levels. So that is the density of pump energy at which the laser start to work. And the lower is the threshold level, the better is the laser. You can see the dependence of the threshold of a laser action in dependence of different years. First laser were made in a simple heterojunction, and you see here how high is the level of threshold. Further, double heterostructure, employing the double heterostructure, one can reduce the threshold up to this level. Further, by using quantum wells, that is one-dimensional structure, by using quantum wells, the threshold can be reduced here to 10 to second power. Finally, by using quantum dots, one can reduce the threshold by, you can see, 1, 2, 3, by 4 order of magnitudes in comparison with the simple simple heterostructure laser. Four order of magnitude reducing the threshold of lasing power by means of quantum dots. Also, the dependence of here is the dependence of the threshold current of the temperature. You can see that in simple heterostructure and double heterostructure, also in heterostructure using quantum wells, the current depends on the temperature. Anyway, by employing, you can see that the threshold is reduced by employing double heterostructure, by employing quantum well, but only in quantum dots, in heterostructure using quantum dots, the current is, the threshold is not anymore dependent on the temperature, and it's four orders of magnitude as I showed lower than in the usual heterostructure. Here we can see the different example of quantum dots in a assembled in a matrix. For instance, here is the germanium quantum dots in a silicon substrate, germanium island in the silicon substrate, and you see here that 20 nanometers. It means that we are in the nanometers, what's the nanometer scale, that we have a quantum dots of German in a silicon matrix. Here is the quantum dots made on gallium arsenide substrate. It is an indium arsenide quantum dots in gallium arsenide matrix. And here is an electron microscope image where the quantum dots is well resolved. Here is the larger resolution of this quantum dot. Further, here we have quantum dots in heterostructure. That is the structure which are used in the heterostructure quantum dot laser. It is a structure consisting of different layers. Again, layers are of the nanometer scale. That is a quantum wells. And inside this matrix, you can see that is array of quantum dots. And such, here again, it is the aluminum gallium arsenide matrix with the indium arsenide quantum dots. And respectively, such type of structures are used in those laser structures which allow one to reduce the threshold of laser operation. Here, an example of pyramidal quantum structure of silicon made on gallium arsenide, aluminum gallium quantum dots, and since we have pyramids here, if one take the spectrum, the emission spectrum for such an array of quantum dots, one can see here that at this photon energy, that is at larger photon energy, the emission from quantum wire. Here we have quantum wells. Here is the emission from quantum wires, and here is the emission of quantum dots. So quantum dots are actually at the very sharp end of this pyramidal structure. The quantum wells are formed at the faces. At the lateral faces of this pyramidal structure, and respectively, in the spectrum, all these type of quantum structure are well resolved. And on the basis of such type of pyramidal structure, one can also make a cantilevers for atomic force microscopy, for instance, with the quantum dots at the at the very sharp edge. The single electron tunneling, again, if one construct a structure based on a two-dimensional electron gaze by means of lithography, we will define a structure consisting of different quantum wire here, and again, and in such a case, we have again we have a source, we have a drain, and we have two gates. Gate 1 and gate 2. By applying the voltage to these two gates, one can realize that the transport, the current through the through such type of field effect transistor, and you can see that not at all voltage the current is passing through the transistor. Only at discrete voltage we have pulse, we have current pulses through this type of transistor. It means that we have a single electron tunneling through these quantum structures. That is ballistic transport work, and again a part of that single electron transistor can be constructed on the basis of such type of structure at nano dimension, when we go to nano dimension. Another type of quantum dot structures are so-called colloidal. That is dots which are made in colloid, and they are dispersed in liquids, and depending on the dimensions of quantum dots, one can see here the proper that the development of such type of quantum dots structure, and respectively on the basis of such kind of quantum dots, similarly to structure based with quantum dots inserted in heterostructure. Here again, one can make quantum dots laser, and in time you can see that the evolution of quantum dots laser based on quantum dots, colloidal can be made of different materials. This is for 2-6 material, for 1-7 materials, for 3-5 materials, further for perovskite quantum dots, last years are widely explored. And you see here, after 2010 years, commercial application in display devices employing this type of colloidal quantum dots. And you see here that I told you that the light which is emitted from the quantum dot depends on the dimension of the dot. For instance, quantum dots made of these material is the same, is not changed, but the emission, you see here that the emission decreased from 700 nanometers to 400 nanometers, independence of the dimension of this quantum dot. Decreasing the dimension leads to the decrease of the wavelengths from 700 nanometers to 400 nanometers. Respectively, here is a perovskite colloidal quantum dot assembled in a layer, and respectively the emission, photoluminescence emission, and the photoluminescence and the absorption spectrum of such kind of layer composed of self-assembled perovskite quantum dots. Colloidal quantum dots application in photodetectors. You can see one can assemble a more complex structure consisting of a ITO glass. That is a substrate covered by a conductive indium tin oxide layer. Further, a thin layer of zinc oxide is deposited, gold nanodots, and respectively hydrargyrum tellur quantum dots from colloidal from colloidal solution. Further, molybdenum oxide layer form gate and a contact, just a ohmic contacts, gold ohmic contacts. And you see here the dependent of the detectivity of this photodetector as a function of the wavelengths. The detectivity of a photodetector made in such a structure without nanodots and the detectivity of such structures with the with nanodots. You see here that apart from a sharp increase in detectivity, also the spectrum is a little bit narrow. More application of colloidal quantum dots referred to Foster resonance energy transfer, that the transfer energy between two quantum dots, and respectively here the emission intensity, the emission intensity of a device composed of two types of quantum dots, between which Foster resonance energy can be transferred. A more complex application of colloidal quantum dots in a so-called whispering gallium moons biosensor. Whispering gallium moons is the model structure. You know that there are different types of resonators. The simplest resonator is a Fabry-Perot resonator, which is made of two mirrors. One mirror is non-transparent, another mirror is semi-transparent, and passing the light through this kind of resonator, one can reach a laser effect, respectively the model structure is determined by the distance between these two mirror and by the dielectric function or the initial refraction of the material which is in between the two mirrors. More complex structure is a cylindrical structure, which supports the so-called whispering gallium moons. That is, light is reflected, you see here, is reflected in different points of such a spherical structure. They form a closed trajectory and respective mood of the resonator appear, and the frequency of this mood structure depends on the environment. And if such a quantum dots, a colloidal quantum dots, is used as a resonator, that means as a cavity, and we have a laser which excite the quantum dots, we have a detector which detects the light passing through this quantum dot colloidal solution. By if you will register the at the detector the dependence of the spectrum, it will depend on the environment. And if some bio objects will approach these quantum dots or will attach to these quantum dots, the frequency will be changed. Respectively, the detector will register this type, and each type of biological object which will attach to the quantum dots will have its fingerprint, and by registering the frequency, one can determine which kind of biomolecule is attached, and by the independence of the intensity of the intensity change, one can determine the intensity, the density, that is the number of this molecule attached to the. Another application is the nanoplasmonic. nanoplasmonic is determined by the metallic, not necessarily metallic, but highly conductive quantum dots. And this, in highly conductive quantum dots, a new type of excitation appear, which are called plasmon. That is a collective oscillation, collective oscillation of electrons inside this. When the dimension is reduced to nanometric level, a resonance of electron oscillation occurs, and these resonant oscillation are called plasmons. And they are this type of plasmonic quantum dots are widely applied in different in the light emitting devices, also in detectors, and also in solar cells. For instance, here is the application of nanoparticles, particularly of nanoplasmonic structure, that is quantum dots made of highly conductive materials, maybe basically metallic materials. Gold is usually used, platinum is used, or silver is used as quantum dots particle. And if such kind of particle are inserted in solar cell, the efficiency of solar cell is highly increased. And you see here such type of application of quantum dots in a solar cell. Last time, maybe last 10 years, wide exploration started to have different carbonic structure. And carbonic structure are again very, very broad, if one refer to the type, to the structure and to the type. Fullerene is a spherical structure. The most famous fullerene is the so-called carbon 60. That is a sphere which is composed of 60 carbon atoms, and they form such kind of ball fullerene. Graphite can be graphite actually is composed of single layer of carbons. If one manage to disperse a single layer, we will have a so-called graphene. But the graphene is a single layer of carbon atoms, and actually the properties are completely different. If one takes the property of graphite and the property of graphene, that is a single layer, actually it's the same graphene, but it's only a single layer. The property, of course, due to reduction of dimension to nanometer scale, it's completely different. Also different are the property of such type of fullerene, that is ball structure, and carbon nanotubes. Another structure is carbon nanotubes, and there are different types again of carbon nanotubes. One can elaborate a single well nanotubes. One can elaborate the double well nanotubes, and again the property of these nanotubes will depend on the structure. Is either single well or is a double well carbon nanotube. It will depend on the dimension, because one can have different radius of it. And this structure start to be widely used in new device on electronics, optoelectronics, but not only. Even mechanical application, because if one make a fiber made from reduced to nano dimensions, made of carbon atoms, their mechanical properties are completely different. They are very strong, and by introducing such type of fibers into, for instance, in polymers, one can elaborate very hard. From one side, on the other side, flexible materials, which are widely used, for instance, in the space and in the construction of planes and in the plane industry, especially in the wings, making for wings for plane. For instance,
the last plane, which is elaborated, which is actually in elaboration by the Russian company, now has a big problem, because the exporters are due to this limitation for importation imposed by restriction. They are not allowed to buy materials for the construction of such wings, and to develop their own, because it's not such a simple technology to prepare, because it depends on the type, on the dimension of this, or on the composition of polymer carbon nanotubes and so on, and so they are now forced to develop their own technology, and respectively the development of the plane is hardly postponed. Well, apart from nano optoelectronics and nanophotonics, another, as we've seen from the very beginning of this lectures, there is also a superposition of electrical properties with mechanical properties, and this superposition at the electrical properties with mechanical properties refer to nanoelectromechanics, and this is another field of implementation of quantum structures in nanoelectromechanic system. Here are several types of such type of electromechanical system, where the mechanical properties in conjunction with electrical properties and also with optical properties leads to new types of devices based, and they may be based on carbon nanotubes, on molecular motors, electron shuttle. But this field development of this broad field of nano optoelectronics and nanophotonics is not a very cheap entertainment. It costs very much. You can see here, for instance, only to found a startup for instrumentation will need more than $2 million, and this is only the proper running cost, but of course the cost will increase with the development of the company, so that you see that one needs to have a lot of money for development the infrastructure, because here is the development of technology, here the investigation of the produced is the production of devices based on the materials, and the characterizing the devices. You have seen that the characterization equipment is also very, very expensive, so that one needs a lot of money for development such type. But in Moldova, one can try to develop a cheaper, for instance, as I told, quantum wires can be made not only by using electron beam lithography, and not only by using molecular beam epitaxy, but can be made by cheaper methods, for instance, electrochemical dissolution. If one talk about the bottom up or about the top down approach, we have a bulk, for instance, a semiconductor substrate. We applied electrochemical etching, as I think Eduardo in the previous presentation. So one can have some specific field of application, not just having such expensive materials and expensive technology. Well, finally,
As I told we in this one hour lecture, we can cover only the very top of that iceberg, and the big part of the iceberg is underwater. Each of you can start exploring their field of this underwater. Of course, nobody of us are able to cover all part of this iceberg, but anyway, in order to develop a specific field, one needs to have a general impression, a general knowledge about the phenomena which are on the basis of exploring this specific field. And the basis are quantization, quantum transport, quantum confinement, and so on. And here's some bibliography, basically handbooks, that is big portions of information, but also at the end here there are some reports in journals, that is review articles. And also you can find in the internet, you can find presentation from different authors. I actually use some of them, some of this presentation along with the material from this bibliography content from the monograph. I have used also some slides from the presentation. There are several, but of course by navigating through internet you can find many more. So that's all. Thank you.